Good to have you with us.
Thanks, Chris.
So how do you feel it went for you up there tonight?
I thought it went phenomenally well, and I just want to give full credit to the CNN moderators for talking about the seriousness of the fourth industrial revolution and automation. We're here in Ohio, and Ohio has lost over 300,000 manufacturing jobs and went 8 points to Donald Trump in the last election.
But that's a good story, but it's not the reality. That's what Senator Elizabeth Warren said. Innovation, you know, sounds good, makes great story, not why we're losing jobs.
The studies I've seen say the exact opposite, but I had an exchange with Elizabeth during one of the breaks, and I said, I think audibly, I said, I have the data. And so she said to me, I want to see the data, and I was like, fantastic. So hopefully we'll get her the studies that I've been referencing for months now.
So this line of questioning is actually going somewhere, I promise. If you know that the data is obvious, that when you look at most of the things online, it's somewhere between 6 and 8 of every 10 jobs that we've lost in the manufacturing sector, they say is innovation. And this came as a novelty to us about 10 years ago when this thinking started, because we all thought it was just straight wages and selfish companies. It seems like Warren wants to go back there because it can't be about a fair difference of opinion on the data, Andrew, because I don't think you could come up with a lot of data on her side of this, can you?
Well, you know, I certainly give her the benefit of the doubt, but the fact is if you go to a factory here in Ohio, you'll find wall-to-wall robots and machines. And even this GM strike, the UAW strike that's on right now, it's tied to the fact that they're shifting towards electric cars that have fewer parts and so need fewer workers to put them together. Even the UAW strike is an automation story.
So here's why I'm asking. Because if her theory of the case is corporations are bad. She said tonight, corporations don't care about people, they care about their bottom line. Now, with fairness to them, they did come out with that new motto lately, the corporations, that's saying the bottom line isn't our only thing, we care about communities. I'm smiling because they've got to prove a lot more before we can believe their new motto. But if that is the push for the Democratic Party, corporations bad, tax the rich, and that's how we'll get free everything, you think that beats this president?
You know, we've set up a system of capitalism that's very, very good at maximizing the bottom line for big companies, but now that bottom line doesn't match up to the lived experience of most Americans. And so what we have to do is we have to go to the American people and say, look, we get it. This economy has left millions of our fellow Americans behind. It led to Donald Trump being our president. And here's how we're going to rebuild. Here's how we're going to put resources directly into your hands so that you're going to think your kids have a better future ahead of them and a more secure future. If we fail in that, then we will lose to Donald Trump.
The challenge in politics is often what is criticized in the campaign is what winds up being most practical in governance, which, you know, the old expression, you campaign in poetry, you govern in prose, that incremental works in policy. Are you worried that if the Democrats buy into in their nominee an idea of revolutionary thought and transitional change, that it's not what the party really wants, which is a return to normal and things that they understand?
Yeah, I mean, I get it. The fact is, our economy is transforming in fundamental ways before our eyes, and it's very, very hard to keep pace. And it's very natural and human for us all to try and reach back to some more comfortable past. But the future is coming whether we like it or not, and we have to play catch up as quickly as possible. So to your point about transformational change, as president, everyone will know that I won the White House because I've run on this dividend of $1,000 a month. And so the Democrats will be so thrilled to have gotten Donald Trump out of there. They'll say, let's do it. It's going to make kids and families stronger and healthier. But here's the kicker, Chris. Republicans are going to look at this and say, wait, am I against the dividend? It helps rural areas. It helps red states on the interior that have gotten blasted by automation. And the one state that's had a dividend for almost 40 years now is a deep red conservative state, Alaska, passed by a Republican governor. So we don't need all of the Republicans in Congress to get on board. We just need a handful of them. But that's what my campaign is about. I'm one of only two candidates that was on that stage tonight that 10% or more of Donald Trump voters say they would support in the general, which is one reason why I'm going to be the strongest person to take on Donald Trump and beat him in 2020. But that's also how I'm going to get things done in Congress, because if I peel off 10, 20% of Republicans in Congress who say, wait a minute, this is actually a huge win for Kentucky, huge win for Missouri, et cetera, then we can make real changes. Mm.